Good morning, students. In routing algorithms, the first algorithm is the shortest path routing algorithm. In shortest path algorithm, we are going to discuss the Dijkstra's shortest path routing algorithm. In this algorithm, in a graph or a subnet, each node of the graph or the subnet representing a router, and each arc of the graph representing the communication line. Okay, see here in this example of shortest path routing algorithm, we need to find out the shortest possible distance from source to destination. Okay, the algorithm is Dijkstra's shortest path routing algorithm. Okay, this is an example. In last class, I have given a brief note about this example. See, in this shortest path, this is the example of shortest path routing algorithm. Here, let us assume the in the graph, those are routers. In the graph are subnet A, B, C, D, all are routers. Okay. Here in this example, the source is A. The source is A. See, in the we have six steps in this example. Okay, in these six steps, we need to find out the shortest path from source A to destination D. Here, the steps to be noted is. Our journey started from router A. Our journey started from router A because A is the source node. A is the source node in the graph, or A is the router. Okay. Here, whatever the working node, see in the second diagram, the arrow mark is at B. In the third diagram, the arrow mark is at E. The arrow mark represents it is a working node. The arrow mark represents working node. Now, let's start with A. In the first diagram, the A is labeled, nothing but it is bubbled, right? The router A is bubbled, nothing but that is the labeled router. In this Dijkstra's algorithm, each node is labeled in the parentheses with its distance from source node along with the best known path. See, in the first one, we have given the weights from A to B. The distance is given, the B to C, from each router to the distance. The connected routers have given the distances. Now, where we need to start? We need to start from A. See here. Note this point, students. Here. We need to find out the best known path. Initially, the no paths are known. Okay, from source to destination, initially, no path is known. So, all nodes are labeled with infinity. In the second step, see here. From A, we have started here, right? A to B, the distance is 2. A to G, the distance is 6. Which is the shortest distance? A to B is 2 and A to G is 6. So A to B, 2 is the shortest distance. So let's move in this direction. We have moved to B. So here we have given the label. See here the label at B. That is B 2 comma A. That represents the distance from A to B is 2 and the line is A. Why? Because there is a direct path from A to B. Now, already this path also we have known, right? So, here we need to write A to G. What is the distance? A to G distance is 6. So, A to G distance. Here we need to present the label here. A to G, the distance is 6 and the line is A. Why? Because we are having direct path from A to G. So, all of all routers will be kept infinity. Why? Because we don't know the distance from A to E, A to C, A to F, and so on. Only as of second step, we know that A to B, the distance is 2 and the path is A. A to G, the distance is 6, the line is A. Okay, we need to keep all other R infinity. Now, where we are at B, the working node. See here, this arrow mark represents the working node. Now, let's move on to the third step. Okay, from B, what are the adjacent nodes to B? B to C. Okay, B for B, C is one node and E is another adjacent node. So we need to calculate the distance between B to C. What is the distance between B to C? 7. What is the distance between B to E? See in the first diagram, B to C is 7, B to E is 2. So A to B is 2, B to C is 7. So A to C will become 9. Now A to B is 2, B to E is 2, then A to E is 4. Okay, you can calculate like that. So in the third step, what is the shortest one? A to B is 2, B to C is 7. So 2 plus 7, 9. So A to C is 9. The line will be B. Now here we need to replace the distance and the line here. Okay. Now A to B is 2 and B to E is 2. So 4 is the distance and the line will be B. So 9 and 4 compare. The 4 is the shortest one. So we have chosen the working node as E. Now where we are? We are at E. Here we need to replace the infinity. Why? Because we have known the distance from A to C here. So it is 9. The line will be B. We have the known the distance from A to E. As of now, 1, 2, 3. At 3 nodes, our labels has been changed from infinity to some distance. Okay. Now where we are? We are at E. What are the adjacent nodes for E? E to F and EF to G. E to F and E to G. E to F is 2. E to G is 1. Right? Here, this is the one important point in the fourth step, students. Just keep on observing. See, A to E distance is 4. E to G distance is 1. Right? Now, what is the distance from A to G? Previously, there is a direct connection from A to G, that is 6. If we travel in this route, A to B, B to E, B, E to G, then the distance is 5 only. Then always we need to choose the shortest path. Then previously there is A to G distance is 6, A. We need to replace this distance as A to G distance is 5, E. E means we need to reach G through E. Now, this also we have known, right? A to E, where is the working node previously? Here, the working node is E, right? E to F is, what is the distance between E to F? 2. A to E is 4 and E to F is 2. Then A to F will become 6, E. Now, one noted point here is, A to G distance is replaced 5. Previously, even though there is a direct path from A to G, the distance is 6. Here, if we choose the route A to B, B to E, E to G, then the distance will be 5. And This also we have to replace. A to F is 6 comma E. Now, what is the working node? G is the working node. Why? Because this is having the shortest one. This is having the shortest one. Here, one small observation need to be done here. See, we need to go back to the previous slide. Okay, to know the fifth step. See, as the algorithm proceeds, we are proceeding towards the algorithm by keeping as the working nodes and changing the working nodes. As the algorithm proceeds and paths are found, till now we have found the paths, some paths. The labels may be changed. See, previously A to G is 6, now the A to G will becomes to 5. The labels may be changed, reflecting the better paths. A label may be either tentative or permanent. Here the label may be either tentative, means that is temporary, not permanent, temporary. It is approximate. Tentative means it is approximate, and the permanent is fixed. See, initially all labels are tentative. When it is discovered the label that a label represents the shortest path possible path from source to destination, it is made permanent. See here, once we have chosen this is a shortest path, then all labels are permanent. Just understand these 2 points, students. All labels may be either tentative or permanent. Initially, we have taken all labels as tentative. When it is discovered that a label represents the shortest possible path from the source to the destination, it is noted to be a permanent and never changing once it has been done. That is, thereafter, it should not be changed. Okay, note down this point, student. We move to fifth step. Okay, in the fourth step, what is the working node? What is the working node? G is the working node. Okay, we need to find out the adjacent nodes. G to H. What is the distance? Distance is 4. See, G to E. Already we have visited. We came from E to G. Even though we need to check G to E and E to F. Okay, what is the distance? Here the distance is 4. Here the distance is 3. Here the distance is 3. Here the distance is 4. So here the G is not a permanent, route. Okay, so in the fifth step, we have chosen. Normally, hope you thought of only, sir, for G, we have 2 adjacent nodes, E, H. Okay, so what we need to do? We need to, if we use this one, the distance between G to H is 4, and previously it is 5. 5 plus 4, 9. If we use this route, A to F is 4, A to E is 4, E to F is 6. Okay, E to F is 2, then it becomes to 6. So in the fifth step, we have chosen, after the last 5 minutes of the class, I will explain in Telugu to understand. Okay, the path will be F. Okay, now what is the distance between A to H? A to G is 5, G to H is 4, then A to H is 9. Now where we are? F. For F, the adjacent nodes are C and H. Adjacent nodes are C and H. For C, the distance is 3. For H, the distance is 2. See here. Here previously, if we come in this direction, A to G and G to H, what is the distance from A to H? 9. If we come in this direction, A to B, B to E, E to F, F to H, the distance becomes to 8. here the label also changes. See here, here the 9 is the distance, here the 8 is the distance. The line is G, the line is F. Okay, now A to H is 8. Now in the next steps, no need to be done. Why? Because H is directly connected to D. This router is directly connected to this node or router is directly connected to D. H to D is, distance is 2. Okay, students, forget about this. Just you can calculate the distance from A to D. 2, 4, the root is A to B, B to E, E to F, F to, see here I will show you, A to B, B to E, E to F, F to H and H to D. This is the shortest path. Why? Because let's check with the distances. A to B, 2 plus 2, 4 plus 2, 6 plus 2, 8 plus 2, 10. Okay? No other routes. No other routes having the distance 10. Okay, this is the best path is A to B, E to F, F to H, H to D. Okay, only you might confused in this step. In the we came here and we go back to E. Why? Because here in the fourth step, the working node is G. The adjacent nodes for G is E and H. If we go in this direction, the distance is high. Then if we go back and next, let's move on to the next node, the distance is low rather than this node. Okay. This is the shortest path routing algorithm. Here, the first five steps will compute the shortest path from A to D. And the arrows here, the arrows will indicate, see here, the arrows will, you need to draw these arrows. Otherwise, there is no meaning of working node. The arrow indicates it is a working node. See this, what are this bubbling? See here, we are here, this is bubbled. The router, that means the visited routes. See finally, A to B we have passed, A to B, B to E, G. And these are the visited routes. Whatever the routes, those are labeled. Those are bubbled. Okay? Those are visited nodes. Those are visited nodes. Okay? This is called as class shortest path routing algorithm. Okay? Second algorithm in routing algorithms is flooding. Here, flood, we know about the flood. Flood means it does not have control. Flood means it does not have control. In network point of view, suppose a router, let's take a router. See, this is very, very important. These topics are very important. And the syllabus is very low. Why? Because all are algorithms. Of course, this is a theoretical algorithm. Here, let's take a router. Every incoming packet to the router, will be sent out to every outgoing line except the one it arrives on. And that means, suppose I will show you in this one. Let's take, you see, these are all routers. From a packet came from A to B. A packet came from B. Here B, the router B needs to be flood the incoming packet. Okay, what it will do is accept the one which it arrived on. Why? Because the packet came from A. Accept that point, all other outgoing lines, whatever the outgoing lines for the router B we have, we need to flood out the packet A to B to C. Then what it will do, C will flood every outgoing line. What D will do? wherever the packet reaches, what it will do is accept the router which it arrived on, that will leave that particular router, and it will flood all outgoing lines. Okay, this is the concept of flooding. Here, flooding. What is the disadvantage of flooding? Flooding will generate the vast number of duplicate packets. Suppose the router is connected to C and a router is connected to D. If both these routers floods a packet, at one router there will be a possibility of duplicate packets. Here, to control this flooding, we need to control the flooding, one measure has to be taken. For a packet which is to be flooded, we need to give a hop counter. What is the meaning of hop? Here, from this to this, A to B is one hop, B to C is one hop. For a packet to be flooded, we need to give a hop counter. Okay. For each hop, it will be decremented. And once it becomes to zero, the counter becomes to zero, the packet will be discarded and no longer it will be flooded. It is some way we can reduce the duplicate packets, and this is the one technique to control the duplicate packets. And see the point number D, the another alternative approach to control the vast number of duplicate packets is selective flooding. That is to keep track of which packets have been flooded to avoid them sending out second time. So that is one more approach. Approach the point number T. An alternative, first one is hop counter. We need to keep a hop counter at each packet. At each hop, it will be decremented. Once it becomes to zero, the packet will be discarded and no longer it will be forwarded. Now the point D is damming the flood is to keep track of which packets have been flooded. Suppose packet A, packet number 10 is flooded. Just we need to keep track. Next time if packet 10 came to a router, it do not flood that one. Why? Because it is keeping track of the packets. Okay. If we flood again, it generates more number of duplicate packets. So here we need to keep track of the packets. Okay. Which packet has been flooded, which packet has been not flooded, like that. So it is the one way of reducing the duplicate packets. Now, another approach is to reduce, this is the practical approach, is the selective flooding. Okay, this is an algorithm, selective flooding. In this algorithm, the routers do not send every incoming packet to an outgoing line. Suppose, as the principle of flooding, every router will forward the every incoming packet. But in this, it do not like that. Only on those lines that are going approximately in the right direction. It will choose some directions, only those selected directions, those are said to be right directions, the routers will be flooded, the routers do flooding. Okay, this is called as selective flooding. Okay, we have discussed so far what is flooding and three approaches to reduce the vast number of duplicate packets caused by flooding. One is to maintain a hop counter. The second one is to keep track of the packets to be flooded. And third one is the selective flooding. In this selective flooding, we need to choose. In every incoming packet will not be flooded further. We need to choose what in which right direction. in which direction it is to be transmitted. Okay, these are the three ways to reduce the duplicates. Okay, the applications where we are using these flooding is military applications. But because the military applications in war times, the message needs to be forwarded. We need to alert all the army and forces. So we need use flooding and distributed database applications and wireless networks, and the metric against with the routing algorithms can be compared. Okay, that means the major applications are distributed database applications. Distributed database means the database is distributed among the distributed systems. Distributed system is nothing but those are networked systems located at different places or within the same place or within the same computer but running in the different process. This is called as distributed systems. In those distributed database applications and wireless networks. Because wireless networks, we will flood because there is no guarantee but that every transmitted packet will be reached to the destination. So it needs to be flooded. Okay. These are the applications where we are using the concept, the flooding. Okay. As of now, we have completed two algorithms in routing algorithms. One is Dijkstra's shortest path routing algorithm. The second one is the flooding algorithm. Now let's move on to the distance vector routing algorithm. Okay, I told you there are two types of algorithms. One is non-adaptive algorithm or static algorithm, and the second one is adaptive algorithm or dynamic routing algorithms. In the dynamic routing algorithms, the routing decisions may be changed. The routing decisions may be changed. Okay. In this distance vector routing algorithm, just I will give you a brief introduction and about the example. Here we have a subnet. This is a subnet. This subnet is containing the routers, and we have. Okay, I will continue this topic in the next class because it is a vast topic. Okay, in the next class we are going to discuss about the distance vector routing algorithm. Okay, and after that we have link state routing algorithm. Okay.